Why do audiophiles think that the last meter of high-quality power cable does make a difference in sound, while it's preceded by perhaps hundreds of meters of cheap cable in the grid? This question is often asked with an undertone of skepticism. Time for some clarification. I have never in my life reviewed audio cables, or any cables for that matter. Not because audiophile cables belong in the snake oil museum, but simply because I might not know enough about cables. A review should give some impression of the product. That's why I always place the reviewed products in one of my sets, or at least try to. The problem with interlinks and speaker cable is that it's not only the quality of the cable, as explained in my book, but also how the electrical properties of a cable fit those of the equipment it connects. To what extent this also plays a role for power cables, I don't know, but there still remain good reasons to use quality power cables. I would even say that of all the cables, the power cables should be the first to be upgraded in a set. Why? For audio signals rely on extremely small voltages to transport details. Many of you might have heard the difference between 16-bit and 24-bit recordings. The low-level information offers more refinement, a better defined stereo image, and what has become known as black background. It's all semantics, and those who warn against snake oil might never have heard a stereo that begs for new use of words to express what you hear. I have also told many times that there are no 24-bit converters that have 24-bit resolution, simply because that would require precision that cannot be made. The 24th bit in a DAC that outputs the standard 2 volts would represent a voltage of 0.24 microvolts, well below the thermal noise for instance, a position resistor. In practice, we measure slightly more than 19-bit resolution in both A to D and D to A converters. The 19th bit represents 7.6 microvolts in a system that does 2 volts at 0 dB full scale. This is all simple math that can be confirmed by any electronic engineer. Now, when we connect the amplifier to the grid, a voltage between 110 and 240 volts, depending on where you live, is applied to the amplifier. Depending on the design of the amplifier, a current of at least half an ampere will travel through the mains cable. Tube amps and Class A amps usually draw clearly more current. And when current flows through a conductor, an electromagnetic field will form around this conductor. Standard power cables are never shielded and often not even twisted, so they will produce a relatively strong electromagnetic field. Most power amplifiers are only 43 cm wide, and the inputs and power inlet are often no further apart than 30 cm, sometimes even less. The power cable and the interconnects almost certainly will be closer together on some point, so there's an almost certainty that some electromagnetic stray will be picked up by the interconnects. But interconnects are shielded, you might argue. And you are right. There are cables that are specified to have 99% shielding. Unfortunately, this doesn't mean that 99% of stray signals are shielded off. Only that 99% of the surface of the core is covered. In practice, this could mean that only 60% of the stray signal is kept out. Of course, it would help to use interlinks that are well shielded, but since the power cable runs far higher voltages and currents, it does make sense to prevent it from leaking. Not only the 50 and 60 Hz, but also spikes and high frequency pollution the modern grid also carries. The first measure is to use twisted cable, for when the cores are twisted so that they form an angle of 45 degrees, this does clearly reduce the stray magnetic field. A second way to achieve the same is to shield the power cable. Combining both techniques is even better. Please do realize that the mechanical quality of the cable does matter. You don't want the cores to move relatively to each other, since that will generate a signal of its own. This is called microphony. And of course the quality of the shielding is of great importance. At the same time, the cable has to comply to the safety laws in your country. They not only have to comply to legislation related to electricity, they often have to be fire retardant too, have specific regional, national or federal specs plugs, and so on. This often leads to relatively small production batches. Furthermore, electronic supermarkets are not interested in distributing these cables, leaving them to a more costly distribution channel that can also answer questions when they arise. Apart from the sometimes esoteric materials used in high-end cables, these factors play a role in the pricing of the cable. Since you now know that electromagnetic stray from power cables will influence the sound, you might try to keep the power cables and audio cables as far apart as possible. Not all audio equipment comes with a detachable power cable, in which case you might want to place that piece of equipment strategically with the power cord as far as possible from the rest of your stereo. If you have money to spend, just replace all cables at once. But if you're like me, you have to take turns at the luxury budget committee. Then start with the amplifier's power cable, since it will draw the largest amount of current and thus generate the strongest stray magnetic field. Plus, this is the place where all interconnects and perhaps also the even more sensitive pickup cable comes together. From there on, replace the power cables and, when that's done, start with the interlinks of your most critical source. Now, you might not hear any difference after replacing the amp's power cord. There can be several reasons for that. Your equipment might not be of sufficient quality, the placement of the set might not be optimal, other faults in the setup might cause more pollution, so the improvement of the power cable is masked, and so on. Audio hygiene is like personal hygiene. You might take a shower every day, but if you don't change your underwear at the same time, hygiene might be less than you would think. You might find this remark funny, but many people are not aware they do something comparable with their stereo. The coming months, I will try to make a series of audio hygiene covering as many things as possible. So subscribe to this channel or follow me on Facebook, Twitter or Google+. You can also post questions, but please don't ask me for buying advice. View my questions video to find out why. You'll find more information below this video, and if you like this video, please support the channel and tell your friends on the web about it. I am Hans Beekhuizen, thank you for watching and see you in the next show or on the HBproject.com. And whatever you do, enjoy the music.